Madam President?
Senator from Delaware.
Are we in a quorum call?
Yes, we are.
All right, ask unanimous consent that the quorum call be vitiated.
Without objection.
Thank you, ma'am. Madam President, 233 years ago, our founding fathers gathered in Philadelphia, just a few miles north of us in Delaware. 11 years earlier, we had declared our independence from the British crown, the most powerful empire in the world. Despite long odds, David overcame Goliath, and we won our independence. But would the government of this new nation endure? When the founders gathered in Philadelphia that summer of 1787, they began debating a new form of government. At times, the differences between our founders, northern states, southern states, small states, large states, seemed irreconcilable. However, a great compromise was eventually reached, and an intricate system of checks and balances was written into a governing document, the Constitution of the United States. Nebraska Senator William Jennings Bryan once remarked, "Destiny is not a matter of chance, it is a matter of choice." Our Constitution has endured longer than any other on earth, in large part because we did not leave our destiny to chance. And today, our Constitution remains the longest lasting Constitution in the world. Our founders, despite their many disagreements, made the crucial choice that this new Constitution would not lead to the creation of an all-powerful king. They came from places, they'd done that, been there, they didn't want to go through that again. And instead, the Constitution created three separate co-equal branches of government, an executive, a legislative branch, and a judicial branch. This ingenious system would ensure that a future president with the impulses of a king would be restrained by the other two branches. The Constitution also provided another backstop against abuses from a future president who committed treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors. That constitutional backstop is called impeachment. As we consider the impeachment of Donald J. Trump, I want to ask my colleagues to remember that while we are here today because of the conduct of one man, the Constitution that guides us through these choppy waters some 233 years later is the triumph and wisdom of many men. We're here because of patriots like Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Franklin, Madison, Hamilton, and many others who lived under the harsh rule of a king and fought for the freedom to govern themselves. Our Constitution gives the House of Representatives the sole power of impeachment, while the Senate has the sole power to conduct a trial in the event the House impeaches the sitting president. We're now at the end of the impeachment trial of Donald J. Trump. It is not the trial that many of us had hoped for. We had hoped for a fair trial. The American people deserve a fair trial. A fair trial has witnesses. A fair trial has evidence. I don't believe that history will be kind to those who have and continue to prevent the truth from coming to light during this trial. The American people deserve to know the truth, as does this jury, the members of the United States Senate. President Lincoln once said, and I quote him, "I'm a firm believer in the people. If given the truth, they can be depended upon to meet any national crisis." Thomas Jefferson said something very similar to that. He said, if the people know the truth, they won't make a mistake. And the same is true of the United States Senate. If given the truth, we too can be depended upon to meet this crisis and do the right thing. I believe the truth will not only set us free, but keep us free. We now have an obligation to consider the evidence presented by House managers and the President's defense team related to two articles of impeachment. One, abuse of power. Two, obstruction of Congress. The House managers have presented a case that is the result of a three-month-long investigation during which the House Intelligence Committee issued scores of subpoenas for documents and testimony. Donald Trump obstructed this process from the start. No president, not even President Richard Nixon during Watergate, has ever issued an order to direct a witness to refuse to cooperate in an impeachment inquiry. As a result of this unprecedented obstruction, the Trump administration did not provide a single document to the House of Representatives, not one. Fortunately, those 17 brave public servants, many of whom risked their careers, came forward to testify under oath. And here's what we learned from them. Donald Trump used the powers of his office to pressure the governor of Ukraine to interfere in a 2020 election on his behalf and to smear his most feared political opponent, our former colleague, former Vice President Joe Biden. Donald Trump did this by illegally withholding funds appropriated by Congress to help an ally, Ukraine, in the midst of a hot war against Russia. Donald Trump did this by withholding a coveted White House meeting from the newly elected president of Ukraine, President Zelensky. The president illegally withheld the funds in the meeting until President Zelensky merely announced sham investigations involving Vice President Joe Biden and a debunked conspiracy theory that Ukraine, not Russia, interfered in the 2016 election. And when he got caught in the midst of this corrupt scheme, President Trump even called for other foreign nations to interfere on his behalf in the upcoming 2020 election. Well, I believe the evidence against Donald Trump is overwhelming. Like any criminal defendant, he is entitled to a robust defense. Many of us listened carefully to the president's defense team over the course of this two-week trial. Not once did the president's defense team rebut the facts of the case. Not once did they defend their client's character or call an eyewitness who could contradict the assertions made by witnesses who testified under oath. Not once did we hear the president's defense team say, of course the president wouldn't use the weight of the federal government to smear his political rival. What do we hear? Instead, we heard distractions, conspiracy theories, unfounded smears about Vice President Biden, our former colleague, and his family. Instead, we heard a far-fetched legal theory that presidents cannot be impeached for soliciting foreign interference in our elections if they believe their own re-election is in the national interest. I believe the House managers proved their case, and there now appears to be some bipartisan agreement that the president abused his power. Still, does this merit conviction and removal from office? Think about that. Our Constitution, agreed to in 1787, sought to establish a more perfect union. Not a perfect union, a more perfect union. The hard work toward a more perfect union did not end when Delaware became the first state to ratify the Constitution on December 7, 1787. In truth, it had only just begun. We went on as a nation to enact the Bill of Rights, abolish slavery, give women the right to vote, and much, much more. Throughout our history, each generation of Americans has sought to improve our government and our country because, after all, we're not perfect. In the words of Senator Bryan, we do not leave our destiny to chance. We make it a matter of choice. And we choose to make this a more perfect union, a reflection that the hard work begun in Philadelphia in 1787 is never, never truly complete. Our Constitution has weathered a Civil War, World War I, World War II, Vietnam, Watergate, a Great Depression, Great Recession, death of presidents, assassination of presidents, and yes, impeachment of presidents. Our Constitution will weather this storm too. But a vote to acquit this president does not exonerate this president. A vote to acquit effectively legalizes the corruption of our elections, the very foundation of our democratic process. A vote to acquit says to this president and to all who follow that you may use the powers of the office to solicit foreign interference in our elections, the very thing that the founding fathers feared. A vote to acquit is the realization of our founders' worst fears, leaving a president with the impulses of a king, unchecked by the other co-equal branches of government and undeterred by the prospect of impeachment. Donald Trump violated his oath. He broke the law. He attempted to cheat in the 2020 election, and when he got caught, he left little doubt that he will cheat again. That is not the conduct we expect of an American president. That is the conduct of someone who believes that he or she is above the law. Donald Trump is our president. He is not our king. So, colleagues, if our destiny is to remain the most enduring democracy in the history of the world, we must not leave this to be a matter of chance. We must choose to preserve and protect our Constitution. And to do so, we must convict Donald Trump on both articles of impeachment and remove him from office. As he left the Constitutional Convention in 1787, Benjamin Franklin was asked this question we've heard asked several times in the last 2 weeks on this floor. Here's the question. He was asked, what do we have? What do we have here, a monarchy or a republic? Franklin answered famously, a republic, if you can keep it. Today, I want to pose the same question to all of us, to our colleagues in this chamber. What do we have here, monarchy or a republic? And I guess we can all answer for ourselves, but I want to leave you with my answer today. And here it is. We have a republic, and I intend to keep it. I yield the floor.